What is up, guys? Welcome back to another video. So today we're going to be talking about the pros and cons about tuning your car, or more specifically the 10th gen SI, or I guess you can say 10th gen in general, since it's pretty much still tuned with K-Tuner on the turbo application cars with the 10th gen. I'm going to do my best to explain everything that I've experienced so far. So if I do miss anything, feel free to comment down below. Oh, that's a nice G37. So if I do miss anything, feel free to comment down below. That way we can get this squared up and help each other out in the comments. So to start off with the K-Tuner, the most obvious thing is it raises your boost. So with K-Tuner, it raises your boost to three different levels. You have your low boost, your medium boost, and your high boost. I can't remember off the top of my head what boost numbers they are for that, but right here, this is what K-Tuner states for the 10th Gen SI. And these are the ones that they state for the non-SI. So like the hatchback, the sport, any the base one, anything with the turbo model. But that's just with the K-Tuner off the shelf. You still have TSP, you still have Variable, and you still also have Hondetta that have also some off the shelf map tunes. I'm not too familiar with Hondetta on the 10th gens. Ooh. That's a nice one. You know, as much as people like to talk smack about boxer engines, you cannot go wrong with how one sounds. That STI sounded amazing. Yeah, so I'm not too familiar with the Hondetta, at least on the L series engines. I'm more familiar with them on the K series, but still, you still get all the good benefits on boosting your car, on raising the boost on your car with either or applications. But I'm going to be talking more about the K-Tuner. So other than obvious one, raising your boost, gotta get used to shifting fast in this car. I'm like a little wary about it, because in my 8th gen I did everything you can do to like make the car shift really fast. I even had Emmanuel take a look at it, and he hooked me up with the upgraded CMC and all the other stuff, so I was able to shift really fast in the 8th gen. But with this one, I still feel like I need to baby it, because I don't shift fast in this car, I'm not too familiar with how aggressive I can be between the gears, if that makes sense. But other than raising the boost, guys, also get better throttle response. So when you put it in sport mode with your factory tune, you do get a better throttle response, so it makes it pick up a little bit better. But with this tune, you get it all around, and the throttle response is phenomenal. It makes a huge difference with this. You barely tap on it. Okay, so that was an STI. You barely tap on it and you get the power that you want, or at least that you're programmed to. So I'll floor it right here. That just hit 22 PSI. Let me do it again, see what I get. I think I'm on map two. I'm usually like chilling on map one. Oh, snap. All right, he's gonna bust a U-turn because there was a car accident right there. I don't know what happened. You guys, drive safe, please. So speaking about the maps, another good thing about tuning your car is you have different maps. So with K-Tuner, you can swap between map 1, 2, and 3, or depending on how many other you have. At least with the K-Tuner, Variable, and TSP, you come with three different maps, like I mentioned before. Low boost, medium boost, and high boost, which they all have their corresponding representing numbers to it, which is very fun and convenient, because you don't always have to go around in like map 3, you don't always have to be in map 2. I personally always go around in map 1, that way if I do need to get up on it, it just cuts me off at 19 PSI, because daily driving to LA and back, I don't need all 22 PSI at hand. To be honest, because I drive so much, I don't really floor it as often as I should. Or wanting to tune your car, guys, is it's very fun and it's quick. It's not fast, but it's quick. It does make your car faster, because obviously you physically gain horsepower from this tune, because you raise the PSI. To say exactly how much, I'm not really sure. Variable says you hit about, on map 3, you hit about 240 wheel horsepower and about 270 wheel torque. With Hondetta, you have, I mean, you guys know what Hondetta looks like. It just looks like a little like tablet without a screen. So it just calls, hook it up to your OBD2 port, and you just like let it hang out wherever you want. With K-Tuner, you have two options. You have option A, which is the V1 version, or you have option 2, which is the V2 version. And the difference is a screen, which I have the V2. I opt for the V2 version because I wanted the screen. You can physically customize each text box to display different information to meet your criteria for you can understand what is going on with your car, which is really nice. So I thought it'd be more convenient for me to hold on to the V2. And honestly, I love everything about it. So I have no complaints on it whatsoever. The two things about this, guys, is the V2 is noticeable. A lot of people like hanging it right here on the left-hand side. And a lot of other people like putting it down here, which you can do either or. I just prefer to have it on display. I do take it off when I park somewhere that I'm not familiar with. That way it's not just like showing on the windshield. So when somebody passes by, it's like, ooh, K-tuner, you know, and then I have to pay for a new window. So I do take it off, I disconnect it, and then I'll just put it back on. But when I'm at home or when I'm at work, I leave it connected because it's fine. With V1, on the other hand, you have it connected the entire time, which is very nice because it is also hidden. No one's gonna know if you're running a K-tuner with the V1 when it's hooked onto your OBD2 port the entire time, because it's not possible. It's just right down underneath there. And on that same subject, depending on what map you leave it on, that's the map it's gonna stay on. You don't have to keep switching to map 2 or switching to map 3 as long as your K-tuner is connected. I'm not too familiar with the Honda. So long as you turn off the car and it's on map 2, as long as the K-tuner is connected and you turn it back on, it's gonna turn on back on map 2. Same thing with map 3. Oh God, I love the hill assist on this car. Do not roll back. Does not roll back. So there's plenty of people running these tunes, these off-the-shelf tunes, and I'm talking about Faribault and TSP, running these tunes for thousands and thousands of miles without any issues whatsoever. But you do also have the risk of that, like, 1% that something goes wrong on their behalf, and it's either because of the tune or because of the driver error. Like, there's many and different possibilities on why it could do that. And that's just another benefit right there. It picks up when I really need it to. Yeah, this is my first turbo car I've ever had, guys, and I have so much fun driving this car. Like, I have no regrets and complaints about it, at least for right now. Keep in mind, guys, off-the-shelf tunes are all good and whatnot, but nothing will ever be a custom tune. You could just buy a Faribault off-the-shelf tune or a TSP off-the-shelf tune, but it is always recommended to get a custom tune. You could still go with Faribault to John Vega and get a custom tune. I think you can e-tune them as well as Derek Robinson from with Two Step Performance, a really, really well known with the 10th Gen series. And they can like dyno tune you. You can get a custom tune from them. You can e-tune, and you can get remote live tuning, which they can tune from their spot across the country or like whatever. Like, that's crazy. I just found that out not that long ago. That is cool. You just have to run a dyno. But a lot of people like doing, and what I'm going to be doing, is you get your basic bolt-ons, you run the off-the-shelf tune for a bit to have a little bit of fun, and then eventually, once you're ready to go, you go get your custom tune. I have different options right here in Southern California to go get custom tunes here, especially because I'm really close to LA. I'm not really too worried about trying to find a tuner around right here. And also, like, just like a side note, because you get it tuned, you do get rid of that nasty rev hang. So, like I mentioned before in another video, rev hang, you either love it or you hate it. So it's just gonna be up to you, and you could change like the throttle response and all the other stuff. Like, it's just so beneficiary to you. It just benefits you so well tuning your car. Another like comment on that, you make easy power with just a tune, guys. From factory, you get what, 205 horsepower and like 192 foot-pounds of torque. Dude, that thing changes dramatically and it wakes the car up once you get just a simple tune. So if you're thinking about getting a K-tuner or a Hondata to get your car reflashed, by all means, I highly recommend doing it. But on the other hand, you do have a couple cons for it, and I'm going to talk about that right now. But that's just the benefits of tuning, guys. Now, the cons, it's going to be very obvious. Tuning your car does void your warranty. No ifs or buts. Understand that. Like, if you are way too worried about voiding your warranty or breaking something, don't tune your car. Don't risk breaking something. Don't risk doing, like, I'm not saying something is going to break when you tune your car or something bad is gonna happen, but you will not be covered unless you can prove that the tune did not break whatever happened to your car's engine or ECU or whatever the case is. I am not 100% certain that Honda can prove that you tuned your car, because a lot of people will just say, and don't quote me on this, a lot of people say that they just take off the K-tuner, they flash it back to stock, they take it in and say, oh, I don't know how coolant got into my oil or something weird that shouldn't just happen. And they'll look at it and be like, oh, okay, cool. Let's take a look at it. Okay, cool, you're fine. But it's not that easy. They're gonna look into it, because they're gonna have to prove that whatever you did to the car is the reason why they will not cover the warranty. Now, on that question, an exhaust will not void your warranty. An intake will not void your warranty. Suspension, unless your suspension starts, your shocks start leaking because you put lowering springs, you'll be fine. Oh, this is always the coolest, like, freeway entrance they have here. I was in third gear the entire time. Ventura, California. So that's that right there. It will void your warranty. Another one, your clutch. The clutch, like I mentioned before, is a hit and miss. Your clutch may hold, your clutch may not hold. It just depends. There's people pushing flex fuel on a stock clutch with a stage 2 tune from TSP. Farable, a custom tune, and their clutch is fine. And there's people on a stock tune and their clutch goes out at like 15,000 miles. It's really a hit and miss, you know? So, or if it just has to do with driver error, it could actually be both. Keep that in mind. With me, I'm babying the clutch on this car. I don't launch it. I don't power shift, or money shift, whatever you want to call it. I also don't ride the clutch. Like, I'm very cautious with the car. But when the time comes and I need to upgrade the clutch, I'm going to upgrade the clutch. And I have two in mind. K20 E-Man's retrofit, since he lives really close to me. Or ACT, not sure yet. Downside about this, whenever you guys do get K-Tuner or Honda, you do need a PC. It's not compatible with Mac. I know with some people that have Mac, they have a program where you can like run PC software onto it. I'm not really too familiar with how to do that, but I have both a Mac and for my editing and a PC, just an old PC that I have in the drawer. Specifically for my tuning, I've had it since my 8th gen, so it makes sense for me to use it for the K-Tuner for the 10th gen. So keep that in mind. When you do get that, you do need to have a PC, not a Mac. Or at least you do have to have some sort of software that... If you do disconnect K-Tuner and you leave it on map 3, when you turn on the car, it's going to lock to map 1. I think I mentioned that before in an earlier video, but just rephrasing that because there's people that still ask the same question over and over on the Facebook pages, on the 10th Gen Facebook pages. If you disconnect K-Tuner and you are on map 2 or 3 and you turn the car back on when it's not connected, it's going to stay on map 1. So the car's still drivable, you'll be fine, but just know that you'll be stuck on map 1. Talking about rev hang, you got to get used to it. Pro is that you could take off rev hang, but the cons is that you got to get used to it. It's driving a different car. So you got to get used to the catch point and everything, because it just drops so fast. So if you don't like it, put it back on. It's not that big of a deal. The last thing that I could really think of for this is when you have the V1, when you're not using the screen, if you do want to have some sort of display for your K-Tuner, I'm not sure with Honda. Actually, I think with Honda is the same thing. But with K-Tuner, if you have the V1 and you don't have the screen, you do have to Honda hack the vehicle, and you'd be able to get a K-Tuner application onto the car. Your display, instead of being on the screen up here or wherever you have it, it'll be on your infotainment system. That's one way to do it. A second way to do it, where I've seen people do, is they get like an Android tablet and they hook it up to that, which works just as good. I'm not too familiar with how that works, investigation, but you do have that option. So you have two options for it with V1. If you really want to get the displays, you gotta Honda hack the car, or you gotta get a tablet so that you can view all the different settings. If there is a different method, comment down below, because those are the only two that I am aware of, and I believe that goes for Honda and K-Tuner. Other than that, guys, just don't wide open throttle under 3,000 RPM, because you're putting a lot of load on the engine when you do that. So just keep that in mind. I know that's like a big issue for these cars, is just premature wear and tear. take care of the car, it'll take care of you, and you should be fine. But yeah, guys, hitting boost on this car just feels so fun. I can't wait to, oh, I already ordered the downpipe, guys. So once that comes in, expect a really good video with a different exhaust tone. That's gonna be hella great. So yeah, like I stated before, once I go somewhere that I'm not very used to, that I don't come as often, I just take it off there. That way, nobody knows that I have it. So it's hidden. Anyways, guys, thank you all for watching the video. If you guys like this video, hit the like button. It really does help your boy out. And let's get it going. So downpipe is coming in. Intercooler is going to be next. And we're going to go and see. What I'm going to do is, I believe there's a local dyno here. So I'm going to go see how much power the car pushes on map 1, on map 2, and on map 3. So we can get real numbers on how it goes. That should be a very interesting video going. But I'm not going to do that until I get the intercooler and the downpipe installed. So I'll see you guys in another video. You guys have a good day. Take care. Stay safe. Peace.